Welcome to this celebration of online worship with the community of Nativity Lutheran Church Allentown. I'm Rachel, and I am delighted that you are sharing this experience of prayer, scripture, message, and song with us. I am pleased to extend a warm welcome to all our viewers, and especially those who are at a distance or who may belong to another faith community. We are all in this together in this time of pandemic, and we hope that online worship will be meaningful and helpful to you. Even though the public activities of this church are presently shuttered, we continue to offer online opportunity for spiritual connection through our social media Facebook page. You can find us there by entering the words Nativity Allentown. We continue in these days to be God's people who offer prayer for the world, for our neighborhood, and for each other. Because this service is available to anyone online, we have chosen not to lift up the names of those who need prayer, but we do invite our members to actively use the prayer list available on our website. And now we welcome you to prepare your hearts for worship, silence your cell phones, settle in on the couch or at the table, and center your thoughts on God's gracious and abundant love as we gather apart and yet still together to worship.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God whose steadfast love is everlasting, whose faithfulness endures from generation to generation. Amen. Trusting in the mercy of God, let us confess our sin. Lord Jesus Christ, we remember with gratitude those people who generously sowed the seeds of faith in our lives. Above all, we recognize how you have blessed our lives with the gift of the Holy Spirit, so that our faith has miraculously and mysteriously grown. We confess the times we fail to involve ourselves in planting any seeds of faith in the lives of others, the times when our personal agendas become more important than yours, the times when we have denied others the opportunity to expand their faith through our lack of interest or involvement, the times when our lives become so entangled with the values of the world that we forget what you have said and done and promised. Lord Jesus Christ, we know that when we become disconnected from you, our lives become parched and unfruitful, and our faith becomes stunted and dry. Bless and renew our lives, we pray, so that we remain connected to you at all times and in all places, strengthening our faith to expand and growing strongly and vigorously to bear the fruit of your mercy, your love, your undying life. Amen. Beloved of God, by the radical abundance of divine mercy, we have peace with God through Christ Jesus, through whom we have obtained grace upon grace. Our sins are forgiven. Let us live now in hope, for hope does not disappoint, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Come brokenhearted. what mysteries there are in God's world.
We stand in awe at the wonders of the natural world. We look at the tiniest of seeds and wonder what will happen. From that small seed will grow a large shrub. Although we consider our gifts to be small and insignificant, God will use our gifts in miraculous ways. Praise the God of small seeds and mighty power.
Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for the mustard seed. We thank you for the wonders of yeast and for how these things teach us about your love. Lord, plant your seed into our lives. Help us work your yeast into our hearts. And wonderful things may happen. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, little friends. I am happy to be spending this time with you today. This morning, we are going to be learning about one of the many ways in which Jesus talks about the kingdom of heaven. And this time, he compares it to a mustard seed. And so today, we're going to do it a little differently. I'm going to have a video for you with two friends named AJ and Howie that will tell you all about the mustard seed. Let's see.
Mustard seed.
I don't see it.
You gotta look real close, Howie. Real close.
I'm looking close, AJ. I really am. But I just don't see it.
But it's there. Here, I got an idea. Try this.
What's this, AJ?
A magnifying glass. It helps make really, really small things look bigger.
Huh. Well, then that should help. Let's see. That's cool.
No, Howie, not like that. Like this. Let me show you. Like this. See? That's how you look through a magnifying glass.
Oh, well, let me try, AJ. I want to try. Can I try now?
Sure, buddy. Here you go.
I love it when he calls me buddy. Now, let's see here. Hey, AJ. There it is. It's a seed. A tiny little seed.
See? I told you. It's a tiny little mustard seed.
Wow. AJ, that is one tiny little seed.
And that's all you need, Howie. That's what God said. It's all you need. Just one tiny little mustard seed. A mustard seed of faith.
That doesn't seem like very much.
That's the point, Howie. It's all God needs. Just one small seed of faith, and he can grow it into a huge bush.
Huh. A huge bush of faith from one little seed. How do I get that little seed of faith, AJ, huh?
Well, see, now, that's the easy part. All you gotta do is this.
Like this?
That's it.
That's it?
That's it.
AJ.
Hmm?
I don't feel like I'm growing any faith.
Well, Howie, dude, you can't just look up. You gotta talk to the guy. You know, just like you talk to me. Like you're talking to your best bud.
Oh, look up and talk. Okay, like this. Hi, God. How you doing today?
Yeah, like that. Now just keep it going.
I'm having fun with AJ today, and we're growing our faith. How's that, AJ?
Howie, man, that's just right. Now just keep talking to God, and he'll do the rest.
You mean he will grow the faith.
He will grow the faith. That's his job. It's his specialty.
I think I can do that.
Good, Howie. That's real good.
High fives.
Yeah. A tiny little mustard seed is all God needs. A tiny little mustard seed is all God needs.
a seed. A tiny little mustard seed will grow. Will grow the bush of faith you need. A tiny little mustard seed is all God needs. A tiny little mustard seed is all God needs. A seed, a tiny little mustard seed will move. We'll move the mountains that you see. A tiny little mustard seed is all God needs. A tiny little mustard seed is all God needs. A tiny little seed, just a mustard seed in the Father's hand is all God needs. Leave your faith up to Him. He'll fill your cup up to the brim. A tiny little mustard seed is all God needs. A tiny little mustard seed is all God needs.
AJ, look at your faith. It's huge.
Howie, put down the magnifying glass.
But it's so cool.
Dude.
See more videos at graceplacekids.com.
So there you have it, little friends. Now you know that for God to grow your faith in Him, all that He needs is the size of a tiny little mustard seed. I hope that you will always remember that, because just with that little amount of faith, God can do great things through you. Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Dear Lord, thank you for giving us the opportunity to continue to learn about your kingdom. Help us to continue to grow our faith in you, and to always remember that even through very small things and very small people, you can do great things. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Goodbye, little friends.
That served the wine and the bread and the sons of the earth. How beautiful the feet that walked the wine dusty roads and the hill to the cross. How beautiful! How beautiful! Is the body of Christ. How beautiful the heart that bled, that took all my sin and bore it instead. How beautiful the tender eyes that chose to forgive and never despise. How beautiful, how beautiful, how beautiful is the body of Christ. And as He laid down His life, He died, willing to bear us, willing to bear us. How beautiful the feet that sound of good news in the love of the King. How beautiful the hearts that serve, the wine and the bread, and the sons of the earth. How beautiful.
The first lesson today is for the third chapter of 1 Kings. Because Solomon did not ask for long life, riches, or the defeat of his enemies, God gave him what he asked for, wisdom to govern the people well. At Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream by night, and God said, "Ask what I should give you." And Solomon said, "You have shown great and steadfast love to your servant, my father David, because he walked before you in faithfulness, in righteousness, and in uprightness of heart toward you. And you have kept for him this great and steadfast love, and have given him a son to sit on his throne today. And now, O Lord my God, you have made your servant king in place of my father David. Although I am only a little child, I do not know how to go out or come in. And your servant is in the midst of the people whom you have chosen, a great people, so numerous they cannot be numbered or counted. Give your servant, therefore, an understanding mind to govern your people, able to discern between God, between good and evil, for who can govern this, you, great people?" It pleased the Lord that Solomon had asked this. God said to him, "Because you have asked this, and have not asked for yourself long life or riches, or for the life of your enemies, but have asked for yourself understanding to discern what is right, I now do according to your word. Indeed, I give you a wise and discerning mind. No one like you has been before you, and no one shall arise after you." Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. Second lesson comes from the 8th chapter of Romans. These words celebrate the death of God's actions for us. Through Christ's death for us and the activity of the Spirit praying for us, we are fused to God's love poured out in Jesus Christ. Nothing, not even death itself, is able to separate us from such incredible divine love. The Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought. But that very Spirit intercedes with sighs too deep for words. And God, who searches the heart, knows what is in mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. We know that all things work together for good for those who love God, who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn within a large family. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? He did not withhold his own Son, but gave him up for all of us. Will he not with him also give us everything else? Who will bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Christ Jesus who died, yes, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As is written, "For your sake we are being killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep to be slaughtered." No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
The good news, according to Matthew, the 13th chapter. Jesus put before the crowds another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed that someone took and sowed in his field. It's the smallest of all the seeds, but when it has grown, it is the greatest of shrubs and becomes a tree, so that the birds of the air come and make nests in its branches. He told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast that a woman took and mixed in with 3 measures of flour until all of it was leavened. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which someone found and hid. Then in his joy he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. On finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. Have you understood all this? They answered, yes. And he said to them, therefore every scribe who has been trained for the kingdom of heaven is like the master of a household who brings out of his treasure what is new and what is old. This is the good news of our Lord Jesus Christ. And now may grace, mercy, and peace be with you through God our Creator, Jesus our Savior, and the Holy Spirit who lives within and all around us. Amen. Welcome to Parable Park. Once again, we're here in the midst of the parable season, and this week Jesus hits it out of the park, covering all the bases with 4 different parables. Now, just in case you missed it during the reading, there was the parable of the mustard seed, tiny but powerful, and much like it, there was the parable of the yeast. A little bit is all you need. The parable of the treasure in the field invokes a little mystery. And finally, the parable of the extravagant pearl brings us home to wonder if we're really ready for this Kingdom of God adventure. So grab your snacks, head to your seats, because in just a few moments, Jesus will be coming up to bat. You know, just like the fans who enjoy the game, it doesn't make much sense until you learn something about the history and the rules. The same is true for parable fans. Unless we can understand how Jesus' original fans heard and understood these parables, they just won't have the same power to change our lives. So let me give you an example. A few of you may have been married years ago when the service in the Red Service Book and Hymnal, or the Common Service Book that came before that, had the bride and the groom saying, "For better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health," ending with this phrase, "And thereto I plight thee my troth." Now I understand that you said it because the preacher said you had to, but how many know what they actually said when they plighted their troth? This ancient Middle English phrase crept into the marriage service, and who knew what they were promising? So since I didn't know either, I looked it up. A plight is a perilous and dangerous situation, and as a verb, to plight is to plead with a sense of fright. Well, that may make some sense in a marriage service. In this usage, it means to willingly pledge to care even in the midst of risk. And how about the troth that you plighted? Troth comes from the same root word as truth. It means truth, honesty, and faithfulness. So if you plighted your troth, you agreed to be honest and faithful while protecting and standing firm in the midst of any situation. But if you didn't know that background, you would have just thought you were saying, well, let's get married. Not quite. Jesus told them a parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed that someone took and sowed in his field. It's the smallest of all the seeds, but when it's grown, it's the greatest of shrubs and becomes a tree, so that the birds of the air come and nest in it. I always thought of this as a simple story of the tiny seed that thought it could, and even though it was small and did big things, I preached that a few times. Come to find out, the people who were listening were like, "Why is he talking about that nasty weed?" For the people of Jesus' time, this was something you desperately tried to keep out of your garden. One little seed would grow and spread and overtake everything else. The good news of the kingdom that Jesus is actually talking about makes a claim on your whole life, not just a part of it. It invades your whole world and reality and can't be contained only to your spiritual Sunday self. God's kingdom is like that, far more potent than we'd imagined and ready to spread to every corner of our lives. So those routine invitations to read the Bible, to pray, to join in Sunday worship, could be dangerously amazing if we thought these things might lead to our lives being infiltrated, changed, and taken over by God's reality and rule. So Jesus told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast that a woman took and mixed in with 3 measures of flour until all of it was leavened. Similar to the mustard plant, yeast was a contaminant and almost always represents the terrible nature of sin when it's mentioned in the Bible. While we may think of yeast as a good thing, in the biblical world, yeast was a sign of impurity, and kneading it into the flour irreparably tainted the loaves. A little bit can get into each of us. So be careful. People who've been infected by the gospel have done crazy, countercultural things like sharing all they have with others, standing up for their values in school or the workplace, looking out for the underprivileged, and sharing their faith with people around them. If we listen closely right now, these parables will serve as a much-needed word of encouragement. Hang in there. God's new reality is closer than you think, already seeping into your life, even though you can't always feel it. These parables bring a profound promise. No matter what it may look like, God's kingdom will prevail. And so, in the face of war, we claim God's peace. When confronted with illness, we look to God's eternal healing. When faced with hate, we proclaim love. Why? Because the kingdom is coming, and before you know it, it will transform everything. Jesus goes on to say, the kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which someone found and hid, and then in his joy he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. That one sounds almost a little crazy. What in the world could be worth giving up all that we've worked for, all that we've bought and saved? If you're asking that question, you're finally starting to understand the power of these parables and the lure of something so different, so much better, and so deeply real. Jesus goes on. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. On finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. For those who are content, selling everything to possess a single pearl, no matter how valuable, seems a little crazy. How can anything be so precious as to give up everything else to possess it? But to those who are dissatisfied with the status quo, with all that stuff that promised happiness and only brought bills, with the values, stereotypes, or prejudices of the culture, then Jesus' gospel, while still disruptive and even upsetting, nevertheless feels true and real and something worth buying at any cost. For those of us who may not be quite ready to take the full plunge, our church family is the place where we remind each other of God's promises and point to places in our lives and the world where we catch glimpses of its presence. I think of the person who overcomes addiction or prejudice in order to cope with a change and change a challenging reality. The kid who befriends the friendless, the one who finds joy in sacrifice. Those who are stunningly generous. The person who sees and stands with the marginalized, and those who, in the face of illness, offer courage to others. The ones who use their power or popularity to uplift others. These parables give us a chance to experience the kingdom life and the reality Jesus wants us to know about. And for all of us, Jesus is making a promise that God's disruptive, life-changing, and ultimately life-giving kingdom is coming. And it will take some patience, trust, and perseverance to await it. When it comes, it will likely not be what we expected, and perhaps not even what we wanted. But to those who recognize there's something more out there than the world has offered so far, to those who are willing to acknowledge the deep ache in their hearts for a sense of true and elusive joy, then it will come as more than we could have imagined, and will invade, will take over, and even transform our lives. And that's something worth rooting for. Amen.
Confident of your care and help by the Holy Spirit, we pray for the church, the world, and all who are in need. Merciful God, your reign is revealed to us in common things: a mustard shrub, a woman baking bread, a fishing net. Help your church witness to the surprising yet common ways you encounter us in daily life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. When your word is opened, it gives light and understanding. Increase our understanding and awe of your creation. Guide the work of scientists and researchers. treasuring the earth, may we live as grateful and healing caretakers of our home. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. As the birds of the air nest in branches of trees, gather the nations of the world into the welcoming shade of your merciful reign. Direct leaders of nations to rebuild trust with each other and walk in the way of peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Your Spirit helps us in our weakness and intercedes for the saints according to your will. Help us when we do not know how to pray. Give comfort to the dying, refuge to the weary, justice to those who are oppressed, and healing to those who are sick. Those who are listed in our bulletin and those we hold in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In certain hope that nothing can separate us from your love, we offer these prayers to you through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
May Christ richly dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have the strength to understand with all the saints what is the breadth, length, height, and depth, and to know the love of God in Christ that surpasses all understanding, that you may be filled with the fullness of God. Amen.
What a fellowship, what a joy divine.